Chapter 4, Energy from Combustion, Part 2. In this lecture, we're only going to focus in on the fundamentals behind the production of petroleum and its components. First, I want to review alkanes. We've talked about them previously as molecules containing only carbon and hydrogen, often referred to as hydrocarbons, and we reviewed how to name them, at least the most simple hydrocarbons, and we talked about if it had one carbon, it would have a prefix of meth, and the structural formula looks something like this. This is comparable to the Lewis structures we've done previously, but structural formulas often don't include lone pairs, if there are any. It is assumed that you are so familiar with Lewis structures that you would know to add them, if need be. And this is the condensed structural formula. The condensed structural formula often gives information about how the atoms are attached versus just the molecular formula. And we'll see that in ethane. This is the molecular formula, C2H6, but that doesn't give as much information as the condensed formula, which clearly shows that there's one CH3 group, referring to one of these, and another CH3 group side by side. These are the other alkanes that you should be relatively familiar with in this chapter. We talked about propane in your outdoor barbecues, and butane as well. Anything with a prefix of bute has four carbons in it. The N in front of the name here just refers to the fact that it is all the carbons in a straight line, essentially. One carbon, then another, then another, then another. You could actually take one of these carbons, remove a hydrogen, and attach that carbon there. It would still have four carbons, but it wouldn't be the simplest, straightest form of butane. And here's again the condensed, which shows a little bit more information about the connectivity. And then we have pentane, pent, for five carbons, hexane, hex, for six carbons, and heptane, hept, for seven, and octane, oct, for eight. Some of these are very similar to the prefixes you might use in naming molecules, but a couple may be slightly different. Bute, for example, instead of tetra. Let's watch an overview on the oil refining process. Now, let's take a look at distillation. So whenever you heat something up, you are distilling it in a sense, but you're trapping the vapors in your pot usually, or you're just not collecting them if the vapors evaporate. Now, it's not too different in the laboratory setting where you heat a container and it begins to evaporate. Only in the laboratory, if we actually want to distill and collect the vapors, usually we have some type of cooling jacket. In most cases, it's just cold tap water. And what that does is the hot gas comes and circles around this area, but that gas that does make it down here is cooled suddenly, condenses to a liquid, and then drips out into the receiving vessel. This is an example of large-scale distillation. And really, what we do with crude oil is not too different. You can see these towers here. That's where a lot of the distillation occurs. Thinker buddy question. At which location in this distillation column will kerosene and diesel fuel, C12 to C18 hydrocarbons, be most likely collected? A is at the very top of the column. B is just below that. And C is just below that, and then at the very bottom of the column is D. C is the best answer. Usually, these hydrocarbons are separated in chambers of maybe six carbons or so, roughly. So at the very top, you get the lightest hydrocarbons, maybe C1 through C5 are methane, propane, butanes. Then in the second highest, we would get slightly heavier, more along the lines of what's in gasoline, your heptanes, your octanes, your higher carbons up to maybe around carbon 11. And then just below that, you'd have slightly higher carbon compounds, such as those in kerosene and diesel fuel. At the very bottom of the column are those with many carbon atoms, like say 30 or so, that hardly evaporate at all in the temperatures they use for distillation. Some of the applications would be creating tar for roofs or asphalt. Thinker buddy question. Which is the major product of crude oil in the United States at this time? A. Lubricants. B. Jet fuel. C. Gasoline. Or D. Manufacturing plastics. Well, you know, with all that we drive, it's going to be gasoline. We do use a fair amount in plastics, but nothing on the order of what we use for driving. So as you saw from the videos, there's a little disagreement about whether or not we're going to reach this peak oil point where our output of gasoline or crude oil production greatly slows. Now, even in the last year or two, there have been advances in technology as well as approval for the development of fracking. And the fracking of the earth to obtain natural gas has expanded the potential for U.S. energy reserves by a significant degree. Fracking is where water and sand and other chemicals are injected to the earth to release gas, natural gas stores. So, whether or not we'll actually have some kind of calamity where we suddenly start to run out of oil, it's difficult to say. Additionally, there are more technologies available for deep sea drilling. Unfortunately, the melting of the polar ice caps is creating a lot of exposed land mass where we may be able to drill for oil. What it comes down to is we really don't want to depend on a non-sustainable source of energy. So we need to try our best to avoid a scenario like this. This ends the second part of Chapter 4.